Welcome back to Not Just a Nurse Podcast. You're here with Nurse Jax and another wonderful guest.
Okay, so we're back. And today I have the pleasure of interviewing my family. We're going to start our Black History Month talking big because we have two Black pilots with us. One is Anthony and the other is O'Neill. Anthony is my brother and O'Neill is my first cousin. So we're going to find out about how COVID has affected the airline industry and how they feel as Black pilot. This is Black History Month, and I think it's worth celebrating because I'm proud that they're my family and they're Black pilots. So first question. So Neil and Anthony, I want you to introduce yourself to us.
Hi, everyone. I'm O'Neill Suarez. Pleasure to meet you. Jax is my cousin.
Hello, right. Everyone. I'm Anthony. Pleasure to meet you. Jacqueline is my sister, and she's doing an awesome job.
All right. Big up, Julia. Okay, so I'm going to ask this first question. You guys both, you could respond however you feel necessary. So let's talk about your journey as pilots. How difficult was it to achieve commercial pilot status? Where did you start? Why did you do it? You know, it's not many of you guys, so we want to hear about that.
And go ahead, O'Neill. You can start first.
I was going to say you led the way, but, you know, hey, all right. For my journeys, it all started, you know, from a kid back in Jamaica and all, and then even coming back up here when I'm in the States. But it culminated for me during fifth grade. I won first prize essay contest. Fifth grade. First prize, they took me out to Republic Airport in Long Island, New York, and I got to fly in the airplane. The instructor took me up, put my hands in the control. I took the control and I yanked the plane. I was just like, So I came home. I told my parents, this is what I'm going to do. And they were my best, greatest supporters.
And that's I didn't know that story.
Yes, ma'am.
You see how you don't know? Okay.
Yes, just like I didn't know about you know, your grandfather calling you nurse.
Oh.
About that. Yes, I've been listening to all your podcasts here.
Oh, nice. I love the family representation. Okay, Anthony, what about you?
Well, you may know a little bit of my story. It started in the yard sitting on a piece of log with our grandfather, Mr. Dunn. And we were sitting there looking up in the sky and there's an airplane flying over. I was less than 8 years old. I'm maybe seven. And I said to him, I said, you know, one of these days I'm going to fly that. And he said, really? He did not discourage me. He did not have anything negative to say. He just said, good. You're going to be good at it. Wow. And from that day on, I always have a love of flying. Every time we went to the airport, you know, Jackie, I would stand there with my face plastered to the window. And that's just my spot. Never left that spot until we're ready to leave. So, and then from there, after coming to the U.S., that went to Wingate High School. And then that's where I started my flying career. And it was a great program. And the program was led by our mentor, Dr. David Strawn. And it was a little rocky at first because we had some other teachers there that wasn't from our community. And they didn't have any faith in us. They treated us as well as though we were just, you know, people not to be taken seriously. One of them even said that, I don't expect them to be pilots, you know. And he told this to the principal, and he was our instructor. Wow. He was our teacher. And that left a scar on me. I never forgot that guy's face. I never forgot what he said. Mm-hmm. And when we met Dr. Strawn, you know, he was very instrumental in educating us in the ways of the world. First, before aviation, most of our class, almost, I don't know, 80% of it was about life and what to expect as young Black men going through our life in America or in, just in the world in general, because as you know, we are treated differently. People don't like to admit it, especially Europeans. They don't like to admit that they do treat Black people differently, especially in our field. We face a lot of adversity. A lot of walls are put in our way O'Neill and I experienced this because we went to school in a place where it was very backward in terms of forward thinking and any progression in modern society. And we went to school in Alabama, and a very small town. If you blink, you would miss it when you're driving by. And these people treated us very badly. You know, that was the first place that I've been to in my life, the very first place where somebody of Caucasian persuasion referred to me with the N-word. And that was the first time I experienced that in my life. And it didn't traumatize me because I was prepared for it, because Dr. Strawn took the time to do that while we were in high school. 80% of our class was about that. And that's all he did. And now I know why. Because when I did experience that kind of hate, it didn't shake me at all, because I expected it. I knew it was coming, and it was only a matter of time. So I was insulated. And for that reason, I owe that man a lot. And all of us do, because as as in life, we can't move forward without somebody paving the way. So we're standing on his shoulders, even though he never himself got to be a commercial airline pilot, but he made a lot of commercial airline pilots. And he made a lot of strong men to deal with the world as it is today. Yep. I'll stop talking now.
Anthony, that I call him Junior because we grew up calling you, but I'm gonna use your government name, Anthony. Hey,
I'll still call you.
I'm gonna use your government name today. So Junior Anthony kind of talked about how it was for him going through high school and getting into college, and you guys both went to the same schools, yes?
To the same college, yes.
To the same college, right.
Yeah,
but
to pick up
what was working your way from high school, bringing to now, like, so how was that journey for you in high school, wanting to be a pilot? What were some of the obstacles that you faced?
I wasn't as fortunate, because when I met Dr. Strawn, it was through one of his outside seminars. And he actually came to the school where I was. I wanted to go to Wingate. My parents didn't allow it.
You wanted to go to Wingate? You know why they didn't allow it.
That's another long story. But hey, we survived. This is New York.
That's right. We survived. I'm a Wingate Strong.
But listen, still, and even with the school where we all went, I'm one of only two Queens guy that was there, and I still survived through all of them. They couldn't knock me down. So we still there. But in my journey through high school, again, I didn't have the fortitude or pleasure of having Dr. Strawn there to help during that time. And my recollection, the class that I was in, we did have an aviation program, but I left high school with maybe 2 hours of flight time after we used to go to the airport to get flight time, but I didn't for some reason. One of my instructor, I remember him, he passed, Mr. Cedar. So after the fact, after 3 months, I got my private pilot certificate. So I came back to New York. I went to the school, to the high school. I looked him up. I called him, went to his class, waited for him to come out. And I took my certificate and I pushed it up in his face. And I said, remember you said me, I wouldn't amount to nothing or I wouldn't do this. Look at me, I'm a pilot now.
Oh, wow.
I got out of there, went to school down in Alabama. The school and curriculum and the area was very interesting, just like Anthony said. But what was so amazing is a group of guys that we culminated down there. We brought each other through. We helped each other up. And
you banded together.
Lifelong friendships that will never end. Never.
Wow.
It was because of them and us that I think we all came through. And another mentor that we had, Anthony Manswell. Because again, another reason why I'm looking like this. Again, I grew up, we never saw anyone. We all aspired to be pilots, but we did not see anyone in the cockpit that looked like us at no time ever. So
absolutely. And it's still very far and few in between. I think the only reason why I know so many Black pilots is because of you two. Other than that, I don't come across Black pilots often. And you know, you come across a Black pilot, you're like, I'm like, oh, you must know my brother, because it's only about 6 of y'all in the industry. But but I know there's so much more.
I'd like to add something about Anthony Manziel. You know, for me personally, there's a lot of challenges while we were there in school and a lot of pressures. Some of our instructors, not the flight instructors, but our ground instructors, didn't want us there. Wasn't comfortable with us being there. Didn't want to see Black men attain this goal and to achieve any wealth. So, you know, that's the overriding objective, is to keep us in poverty. So this job would elevate us to a different status. So a lot of times, because of that pressure, me personally, I just wanted to quit. I wanted to quit and I wanted to go home, because you being in that negative environment all the time, you get frustrated. And when you find that you have limited power, it makes you frustrated. You get angry and you want to do something that's not going to help your cause, which is quit. So every time that happened, Anthony would always show up at the right time. It's as if he heard us calling him. Emotionally, mentally, he heard us calling him, and he would show up. We would get a phone call and go, "Hey guys, I'm coming down. I'm gonna fly by. Everybody be outside," you know. And we would all stand around waiting. And some of our instructors, our ground instructors, would come out and say, "Hey, why are you guys standing around out here?" And we would say nothing to him. We just looked at him and like, "Oh, we're just hanging out. No reason." And a few minutes later, here comes this airplane streaking by. And he would look up and he goes, "Well, you know, you guys could have told us you were going to get this air show." I was like, "Well, you know, you're not really on the list. You know, you're not an invitee, so you don't have to expect that." We didn't say that to him. But, you know, that was the thought. But the main story is that Tony always showed up when we needed him most. And it's not like, I don't know if anybody called him or anything, but for me, it just seemed like he showed up at the right time. And that kind of rejuvenated all that energy you had to accomplish your goal and put us back on track and get us moving in the right direction again. So for that reason, he's very important to us as well. And there are a few other guys, and the list is long, the time is short. But yes,
yeah,
it was very interesting.
So who was Anthony? Who was he? Was he Anthony one of Manziel, your instructors?
Who is he? He's a mentor. He's a mentor. He's one of our mentors. He's also an airline pilot for the company I work for. And he's always been there. And, you know, we could always call him. And he would always answer his phone or he would always return the call. Yeah. And he always try to help us in every way, not just in aviation, also in life. So that's kind of the lesson. For us to move forward as a community, we need help as Black men. We need lessons in the way of life, not just a curriculum or education or scholastic education. We need lessons in the way of life. And that's what's going to help us and help our community, help our families become better and for us to achieve more.
And as I think saying before, Manziel, he was one of the first. He's one of the shoulders that we're standing on while we're here, because he went through first before us. He endured maybe 100,000 times more than us.
Yeah.
But it's because of him that blazed the way and we saw that it can be done, that we had the motivation to make it through.
And so what's interesting, though, is that you guys are pretty young. You're pretty young Black pilots, and you guys have been pilots. How long have you been a pilot, O'Neill?
For an airline 121 carrier, over 21 years now. And
geez,
I don't know how much longer before that.
What about you, Anthony?
I got my private pilot license in 1993. Do the math. It's a long time. But that's just a license to learn. My commercial license.
You got it before your driver's license.
Did you get your driver's license at 16?
Oh, okay.
Are you kidding me? I was driving when I was 12. Have you forgotten? Anyway.
Yeah, I forgot. No, I did not.
That's a you different took me down subject.
Some very dark roads.
Hey.
Okay.
Let's stop blowing up my spot. We gotta edit.
Okay,
that.
I'm gonna, anyway. Okay, edit.
So that. Yes, from 93, I have my first official pilot license. And then after that, the commercial instrument. And then after that, my multi-engine, which is a rating, not a license. And we left school. I left Alabama after that rating. Came out to New York, worked for a while, went back, did my CFI. After I finished my CFI, I taught for a while out of Teterboro Airport in New Jersey. And after that, I flew freight for a company out of Bennington, Vermont. And then after that, I flew for an express carrier, a commuter airline, two commuter airlines until I got to my first commercial
the
airline.
The big gig.
Job. Yes.
So now what plane do you fly?
787. A Boeing 787 Dreamliner.
Ooh, it sounds fancy.
It is fancy.
What about you, O'Neal? Which guys, aircraft do you fly?
Guys that be going fast and be talking about, oh man, I gotta slow down on point eight. Ugh.
I don't even know, like, you're flying and it seems like it's so slow, but I know those planes like are going so fast. O'Neal, what aircraft do you fly?
Well, I fly the Boeing 737, all variants of it.
So it's this junior.
Anthony's on the newer, faster aircraft plane. That's what I joke about him, you know, saying if he goes 0.8, he's going really slow. You know, I can't even 0.8.
Okay, so
tell them what 0.8 Mach means.
Yeah,
don't know what that means.
I have no idea. Please.
Almost the speed of sound. Mach 1 is the speed of sound. Going very, very fast. Very, very fast. I'm going to do calculations right now.
In percentages. So 0.8 Mach, 0.5 Mach, 0.6 Mach. So that's just percentages. 0.8 Mach is a percentage of Mach. So 8 is 80% of the speed of sound. The speed of sound represents a number which depends on how cold it is, what density and altitude is. And that could change, but it roughly around 700 miles an hour. So it's 80% of 700 miles an hour. You can do the math. It's just a basic number and you can figure out how fast that is.
Oh my goodness. I feel a little illiterate right now because of all of this.
You're not illiterate. It's just math, a different type of
It's a different type of stuff, right?
It's just homework. You'd have to do your homework.
So like where do you fly to, O'Neal? What's your route?
Route changes all the time. I'm domestic carrier, so within the 48. So we do some Caribbean and Mexico trips, but within the 48 contiguous United States, anywhere, any state. You pick a state. Well, there's a big gap in the Midwest, but that my company don't go to.
Okay, so Anthony, where's your route?
Mainly international. So it's from Europe to Asia. But the airplane goes other places. It goes to Africa as well, but you know, that's a very senior job. I can't hold that trip. I have to wait until I get a little older.
Yeah, you're so young right now.
So young. You don't see all this gray hair, you know. So
yeah. Oh no, you dyed in gray to look distinguished.
Don't blow up my spot. Don't blow up my spot.
Okay, so I think you kind of answered this, but just to be clear, being a Black pilot, I can imagine it hasn't been easy. But how are you treated among your counterparts, the other persuasions in, you know, white pilots, Asian pilots? Are there a lot of Asian pilots? I know there are a couple of female pilots, but how are you treated? Do you feel like you're treated differently? Do people look and stare? Do people think your guys are like the help, the whole, you know, the, not to demean anyone, but just do people just automatically think you guys are flight attendants?
I'll let Neil answer that.
I've had all of the above. Absolutely.
Wow.
Up front with our peers, generally speaking, our peers with some of them that will accept us as equal and stuff, and nothing in public. But once you know them behind scenes, some of them hold resentment to us. there are some female pilots. I wish there were a lot more, but there are a lot more female pilots than us Black male pilots. Wow. But we're there. We're trying. We make up a very small percentage, and but I think we're up to maybe 11% now of the industry, maybe. But that small percentage of us, maybe 10,000. But look at it. I ask your neighbor, ask your friend, ask somebody who's an avid traveler. How often do they look in the front and see a Black pilot up there? You know, some can go 5-6 years and never see one. Some go a lifetime and see one.
We are what they call white elephant. You know, when's the last time you seen one of those?
I've never seen one. Do they really exist?
Yeah, here we are. We are proof. We exist. We exist. Anyway, but yes, like Odile said, listen, obstacles, they don't go away. And like Manuel says, he says, man, you're always going to get grief from these boys until the day you retire. So don't expect any better. Don't expect it to change. It's just do keep moving forward and don't let them take advantage of you. Don't let them disrespect you. So I give you a story. I was on a flight. That's when I was on the 777. We're flying into Beijing. We left Newark. We're somewhere over Russia, close to the North Pole. And we got a message that our potable water, which is the water on the airplane that they use to make coffee and flush toilets, stuff like that. So that water is almost done. It's leaked out. So flight attendants were a little worried. So my counterpart at the time was, I was in the captain's seat because they call it a cruise captain. So when the captain is on break, because it's one captain and three first officers. So two people take break at a time. So the captain and one of the first officers was on break. And then the relief pilots, which was us at the time, we sit in the cockpit while they go. We're all trained the same way. So there's no difference in level of training, but level of experience, yes, there's a difference. So the potable water leaked out. The flight attendants were a little concerned that they're not going to have any water. The toilets are going to stop working, but the toilets are self-contained and they have water in there. So it just keeps, you know, recirculating. So, however, they were worried about other things on the airplane. So my counterpart, he wanted to divert. And a diversion is to land somewhere else in order to fix whatever problem we have. Since I was the cruise captain, I kind of had the last word. So I said, no, we're not diverting. And then he wanted to wake up the captain. And I said, we're not going to wake the captain for potable water. He's not going to be happy. And it's not a critical system. It's just water. But because the flight is 15 hours long, it's a problem. It could be a potential problem. So halfway through the flight, he wanted to turn around. So he keeps coming at me with all these different solutions. None of them made sense. None of them would create a positive outcome. However, he finally just stuck to let's wake the captain. So I decided, no, we're not doing that. So at some point, I had to kind of be a little bit more direct and a little bit...
Sure.
I don't want to say insulting, but more firm. And he didn't like that, because this is the thing that O'Neill was talking about, is we are viewed as incompetent just by showing up. They don't know you, haven't seen you ever, haven't spoken to you, but they assume you don't know what you're doing.
Right. So how did you get to where they are? You can attest to that, right? Like, you know, you got to the same position they did.
It's called affirmative action. In their mind, that is what they think gave us an opportunity. It may have been the catalyst, but it's certainly not what kept us here. So, yes, we face these obstacles daily. And you have to live with people having doubt of your ability just because the way you look. And that's how you're judged. Whether it's fair or unfair, that's how you're judged.
That's unfortunate, and I get it, but you know what? You guys have broken many glass ceilings and paved the way for the younger generation to be like, I want to be like Anthony. I want to be like O'Neill, a pilot. And, oh. and that is, I'm proud, you know? So it takes us into this.
We're trying to, Jax. Pandemic.
Huh?
We're trying to, but just like Anthony said, it's, we always have to show up. We always have to show up being prepared. We all make mistakes, but we just have to be 10 times better and on our alert or on our game more times than others. But we're trying to make it for anybody who wants to come here, and I'm promoting aviation in general, not just pilots. We definitely need more pilots, but there's 1,000 people behind us that support us to make us do our jobs. And we need a lot more people of us in there as well.
Right. So now that we're in a pandemic, right, the airline industry is hugely affected. And personally, I want to travel again. I've been grounded for a while, but you guys are still working. So is there a substantial decrease in travel and how it has affected the airline industry? Like, what do you think about that?
I'm sure for Anthony, he could describe it. He's probably getting hit harder on his routes, but I do more domestic. We're still hit very hard as well. My heaviest load was about 70% of what it used to be. And it's just starting to come up, and that's very sporadic.
So are you flying, since you fly within the States, are you flying empty planes, or are you flying there are a lot of empty seats on the plane, or are you seeing a lot more people on the plane?
Lately, a lot more people since Thanksgiving. Now, for example, if aircraft holds 175, we're getting, our heavy load was about 120, 143. And then unfortunately, a lot of times we're flying around with 20, 25 people in the back.
Oh my goodness.
Hey, it's your personal space sometimes for some people.
Huh?
Sometimes for some people, it's your personal shuttle.
I know. Well, I'm scared to go in the airport because it seems like every time someone comes out the airport, they come out with COVID. So, you know, there's a myth about, so Anthony, for you, how is the travel international? I know it's like, we can't really fly international, but I know it's happening. So what are your airlines like? What are your airplanes load like?
It's a little bit, okay, I put it this way. The airplane holds about 315 seats. Mm-hmm. And I think on regular occasion, it's about maybe less than 100 people on the airplane. In some cases, mm-hmm. if it's domestic, like O'Neill said, it's less. The only place that I do see a full flight is going into Tel Aviv. The airplane is huge. Most of the time it's full going in, coming out. But that's a special situation. However, I was doing a lot of cargo flying during the height of the pandemic, and there weren't any passengers on board. So for me, it was great. But, you know, flying with passengers, you have to be more cautious. We as pilots, we tend to limit our exposure to the cabin. You know, we don't go in the back of the airplane much. And that's just a personal choice because we're trying to protect ourselves like everyone else is. You know, you have some passengers on board, they don't want to wear their mask because they're being difficult.
Are you kidding?
Because they're being difficult. The airline has a procedure where they would fine them if they don't wear their mask. However, that doesn't happen all the time. Sometimes it's, as you know, the airline very well, they don't like to put their passengers in prison because it's bad for business. So sometimes it's if you do violate the law, it is mandatory that the passengers do wear their mask. It can amount to getting fined, and it can escalate to getting locked up. Not because he didn't wear their mask, but because of other reasons. Maybe they're arguing. Maybe it escalates into something else. But it usually starts there, right? Mm-hmm. So, and there is also a mandate that if you don't wear your mask, you can be put on a no-fly list. That no-fly list banned you from flying.
So for a long period of time or just?
I don't know the extent of when you can get off a no-fly list, but if you get on it, I don't know if you'll ever get off of it because it's a lot of red tape probably to get off of it. It's probably easy to get on a no-fly list. So, and that's the times we're living in because it's important that you do protect yourself by protecting everybody else.
So I'm concerned, like my biggest concern about flying is the air, the recirculation of air. Is that a myth or does that air in the airplane recirculate when you're on the plane or does it, like, how is it, how does it work?
It does recirculate, but it also, by the time it recirculates, it's mixed in with fresh air and also goes through eventually a HIPAA filter. So you get kind of what we call recycled air. It's dry air because of how it goes through the turbine. So there's less moisture in the air. That's one of the reasons why it's drier. But it gets out. For example, if somebody cough or particles is in there, eventually it gets sucked out the exhaust and you get new air comes in. So that's what you're doing. Correct. It does recirculate.
Eventually.
Yes.
Yeah, it's just, yeah. So are you guys concerned about the security of your jobs?
Security of having a job during this pandemic? Yeah, yep. It doesn't matter what anybody thinks or says. It's what the public and the perception that the public has. Because we need customers. If customers don't come back, we may not have a job. And luckily, we're doing a lifeline again right now for the rest of this year, at least with my company right now, for not laying off anyone, furloughing anyone. But again, if we don't have our customers coming back, if this pandemic don't subside.
And we want to come back. Trust me, we want to come back. I want to fly. Do you think that they would mandate vaccinations, the vaccine for flying?
It's coming. It's coming. They're doing it already for the passengers and eventually it's going to come to us. Yes.
So have you guys been vaccinated yet?
No, not yet.
No.
Not yet. So you're considered essential workers, right? So where are you on the list? Did your company discuss that? Like, when are they going to give you the vaccine?
Good question.
Nothing is clear. Nothing is clear yet. Nobody has said anything to us. They are doing something about it. I guess they're cornering the government and trying to get us vaccinated through the company itself. I'm assuming they're going to have it set up where you can get vaccinated because you're a United employee. Other companies, I assume, has done this for their employees. And yes, ironically, I think we should have been vaccinated already because we do travel a lot. We are bringing whatever we get out there back to our homes. So I think we should have been vaccinated already. Unfortunately, the red tape and everything else that's going on is causing a delay. And I think most of it is contributed by our previous administration.
Yeah. Okay. So with that, I wanted to close out with a couple of little questions that people may have in their head. And I know I have them. So the circulation of air was one. Now, what happens when we have all that turbulence and the plane just starts shaking? Is it that you're going through clouds? Like, you know, I don't know. I'm just thinking, like, what exactly happened to create all that turbulence?
You could go, if you want to go through the technical, that might take a while, but it doesn't matter. I have the simplest thing, like what I explained to fifth graders and high schoolers.
I'm a fifth grader right now.
Smarter than a fifth grader? Are you smarter than a fifth grader?
No, I'm not.
I just wanted to example. Listen, just terrestrial heat. And if you're over concrete heats up faster. It radiates the heat up. It loses its heat faster as well compared to over ground if you're just over grass. So you can fly over concrete and all of a sudden you get a push up and you get over a grass line or a tree area. Then, you know, just drop down. Just easy and simple. It's terrestrial heat.
So heat makes the plane go up and what brings it down?
Just the colder air. If you're going in between the two, you're going basically concrete, then all of a sudden you go to dirt. You know, the difference in temperature. The one is a little cooler, one's a little warmer. Just boom, boom. Think of it that way.
Another little question that the fifth grader might ask is, so when you are you autopilot the whole time? Because they're like, pilots, they just press the button and they don't really be flying. So what happens?
No comment. No comment.
Listen, it's mentally draining to be at work, especially when there's weather. It is mentally draining for us. No matter if it's a computer that's doing the work for us, we still have to be along, keeping up with the computer or even ahead of the computer, know what is it doing, what is it supposed to do. So once it starts doing something it's not supposed to do, then we got to stop it, cut it off, take control.
So do you land your own, do you land or do you take off?
No comment, no comment.
Land themselves. They're playing that land themselves. That's
all I say. That's all we'll say.
Do the plane land themselves?
Currently, I'm not.
You have a phone that has the power to launch a space shuttle in your hand. Yes, airplanes land themselves.
So what exactly do you guys do? You don't take off.
We are considered.
You don't keep it flying.
No. I think. So all right. All right. Let me.
Night Rider. Like, what are you saying?
Let me dispel those rumors that you have in your head. We do take off. Planes don't take off on their own. Okay, that's a myth.
Okay.
We do take off. Now, also, there airplanes do land themselves, and that's. It's capable of doing that. And the reason why we would use that function is because, all right, so have you ever come into, you live in the Northeast, so predominantly in the wintertime, you would probably have very low clouds, which we call fog, which is a really easy name for it. So when the visibility is very low, we're human beings, our eyes can't see through that. So all that electronic equipment that we have, we use that in order to guide us to the runway. So the airplane has the ability to guide itself to the runway and land on the runway, on the center line. And we as pilots have to stop the airplane.
Okay.
So we are managers, mostly in this day and age as commercial pilots, we are more managers then we are physically manipulating controls 24/7 all the time. Some of my flights are 15 hours long. Can you imagine that? I'm sitting there for 15 hours flying an airplane.
Essential manager. Say that. Essential manager.
Essential manager.
I like that.
Get it out there. We need the vaccine. We are essential managers.
Essential manager of the aircraft. All right. Making up your own stuff now.
Absolutely. Hey, listen. You got to create another atmosphere, two more.
So why is it that you never see a pilot just like come out of the cockpit and just say hello, just walk down the aisle? You know, you guys are like celebrities. We want to see you just walk down the aisle and say hello to folks and go back in. Since you've been there,
you want to see us? All right.
We want to see you.
I missed that, but unfortunately, 9/11 is one of the things that changed that.
You guys are not allowed to do that?
No, and much less.
Oh yeah, we can.
Pandemic time frame now. No, we don't want to. We have families and lives of our own too. We want to get home.
Well, we want to see you. Come on, we don't.
We don't do it as a choice, but we're not restricted from doing it. But we don't do it as a choice. Like I said before, we try to limit our exposure to the cabin.
Because the only time you see them is when you're leaving the plane. They're like standing behind the flight attendants are like bodyguards. And you see the pilot behind
Absence makes the heart.
Just be like, hello.
Yeah,
thank
you know.
For
yes.
Thank you for flying.
Absence makes the heart go fonder.
Yeah, whatever. Okay, and the last thing, for anybody even thinking of becoming a pilot, right? What would you say to someone aspiring to be where you are today?
You want to start there, Anthony? Huh?
Well, first of all, you have to love this. You have to want to be a pilot to succeed. You can't just get up one day, oh, why don't I try this? Because it's not difficult academically to achieve these goals, but financially, emotionally, psychologically, it can be difficult. And there will be many times when you want to quit, like myself wanted to stop because of the psychological pressures that it is not your own, but the external. So as a Black man, yes, those psychological pressures are there. So, but if you have a love for aviation, and you find most pilots that they really love flying, and that's what makes them successful, because you can't be whimsical about it. You have to be dedicated. You have to study. You have to show up. You have to put in the time, just like everything else, in order to succeed. And it's just a recipe to succeed in life in general. Whatever you put in, that's what you get out. So if you don't want, to study and you don't want to do the work, you don't want to show up at 6:30 in the morning to go fly an airplane when it's 20 degrees outside, maybe it's not for you. But joke aside, it does take a lot of dedication and determination in order to succeed. Contrary to popular belief, you don't have to be a brain surgeon. You just have to be driven.
You
have to want it, but I have to take it in a different level. I love it. I love my job. Every day I'm up there. And you can go from one extreme to the next, to where you're landing 00, you don't see the runway till you touch it. Sometimes.
Oh my God, that sounds scary. I don't want to be on your plane.
You get used to it. The point of it that I want to make is that one of the reasons why I love it is that you have to know a lot of things to do our job, basically. And when I say a lot of things, a lot of different professions, a little bit of engineer, a little bit of a doctor, a little bit of medical, a little bit of meteorology, a little bit of engineering, everything aspects mm-hmm. come into play to what we do. So mm-hmm. I know a lot of things about different career fields that I don't specify in, but we do have to know about it. That's just the joy. And to be inquisitive, and I am like that. I love to learn new things and talk to people and see what they do. And that's what it does for me. But you get a self-satisfaction out of it. I'm telling you, seriously. It's fun. The schedule is great at times.
Eventually, I know, right?
Yeah, let's tell how much your brother works.
Right, let's talk about that one.
Why you gotta focus on me? What did I do? Making me blow my spot up every time, man. Using my government name and everything. What's going on?
Okay, so O'Neal, you recently retired from something.
Oh,
why don't you share with us that? That's huge.
Another industry. Yeah, I recently retired from the military. 23 years in Air National Guard.
Very good. Awesome.
And achieve. Let me tell you, anyone and everyone listening, you are parents, you have kids, even you yourself, there's still time. You can come into this field or do whatever comes to mind. If you want to start over or do something new.
I'll stick with nursing.
Right, Nurse Jack.
I love what I do. And, you know, the three of us are on this panel, and I think the one thing that we have in common is that we love what we do. We knew what we wanted to do from a very young age, and we were determined and we were born for it, you know? So I'm so very proud of you, O'Neal, and I'm so proud of my brother, Anthony. I think I'm your biggest fans. It's not often that you see Black pilots. And you will definitely pave the road, just like you're standing on the shoulders of Mr. Anthony and Dr. Strong. Someone someday will stand on your shoulders to break more ceilings. You know, you're 11%, you said. I think you said you're 11% in the industry. I'm hoping to see, you know, this is 2021. I think we should be at least more than 11%. I'm not even going to give a percentage, but we should be running neck and neck because we're just as smart. We're just as strong. And we just need to believe that. So what are you most proud of, O'Neal?
First of all, just given the opportunity, we will surpass any limitation or whatever gap or
absolutely.
Goal.
Absolutely.
We're always
this gap is too wide.
But what was the question? What goal would I give?
What are you most proud of as a pilot?
Good question. Most proud of as a pilot. Just the way that I met at the time when I was a captain, just the way that I manage my crew, my operation, and how I take into people dismissing me as being a captain during those times. I'm just
you're a captain.
Yeah, not anymore.
I didn't know you were a captain.
Yes.
Did you not tell me that?
What? You totally missed that?
I totally missed that one. You made captain? What? I need to come borrow some chillings over there. You know, that's why you keep it a secret. What are you most proud of, Anthony?
Well, I'm most proud
of all the guys. Don't tell me you made captain too.
No. I think you misunderstood. O'Neal is not a captain now. He used to be in his other airline. That's what he said to you. Okay. You didn't hear him right. But we all did. Mm-hmm. That's a prerequisite to getting to a major airline. You have to have been a captain somewhere else. Some of us are lucky enough that they didn't. But I'm most proud of all the people all the guys that I know that's achieved this goal that they set out to achieve. Because we all know how difficult it was to get here. So I'm most proud of them. I see them all the time. I go to the airport. You know, O'Neal sit there in his uniform. That source of pride comes with a badge of honor because it's not attained with meager goals or with meager effort. It's attained with massive effort, a lot. So and you put in a lot to get out a lot. So any day, anytime you go through the airport and you see a black pilot, don't discount what he did to get there. It's always more than his counterpart. 100% more, you know? So yes, I'm proud of that. I'm also proud of when I go to my kid's school and, you know, career day, and I stand there and I look at all those kids and they look at me with such awe, and their eyes light up when you tell them your journeys and when you tell them where you've been. They're so excited. You know, that's a source of pride for me to see that excitement on their faces. It's like you're fueling their future. Whether they're going to be pilots or not, that excitement overwhelms them and they use it to do other things they love. And that's what I like to see.
Hey, and add to that about the excitement part. I just lost my train of thought on that. But seeing, even though we're such a small percentage of black pilots, we don't all know each other. And
I've had this happen many times. Only three of y'all.
We're going through the terminal and I see somebody I had known them from nowhere, but I just go, hey, what's up, man? I'm O'Neal, how you doing? And we talking, everybody come back and like, hey, where you know him from? You guys grew up together or you got one school? I was like, I don't know, I just met him.
But you guys honor each other. It's a community. And that's great. It's like a brotherhood when you see each other. And I feel that pride. And I see it between you guys because I could see, you know, I'm advantaged because of you guys are pilots and you have other friends that are pilots. And sometimes I'm in a room with four or five or six pilots or more because of you guys. And it's like, I know a lot of black pilots.
But, you know, we love you. We follow you wherever you go as well.
Yeah,
that's right.
Away from us,
Nurse Jackie.
Nurse Jackie,
doing our thing, blowing up.
Doing our thing. So it was a pleasure to have you guys. Thank you for taking my invitation. You're so welcome. Excited! I can't wait to launch this episode. It's gonna be so good. Oh my god, it's gonna be.
Make
so
sure
good.
You edit it properly.
Lots of edits.
Okay. I'm gonna
edit.
don't think I want to edit.
Look,
I like
we
the
need
blooper.
To approve the final product.
No approve it. You will see the final product.
We need to have veto power here.
Well, thanks again and enjoy. And I had a wonderful time with you guys. So just hold on 1 second and I will be saying goodbye. Any last words?
Hold on. Yes. Before you go to one of your previous episodes, you were saying, I think it was a nurse from Israel, choose life that you guys are talking about. So when you're talking about this COVID and you're talking to people, yes, please choose life. That's the last thing I want to leave.
That's right.
Yep, choose life.
That's right. All right. That's a good message. That's a good message.
Good message. Thank you, guys.
All right.
Thanks for tuning in with Nurse Jax at Not Just a Nurse Podcast. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to Buzzsprout, Apple, and Spotify. Send your requests and your questions for a chat with Jax. Be safe out there.